Hi guys, today we're going to be talking about mollusks. And this phylum of invertebrates is actually going to be broken up into three separate videos. And you might think that's a lot compared to our normal one video per phylum, but mollusks have a lot of groups contained within what a mollusk is. And because of this, we're going to be talking about all the groups today and kind of their shared characteristics and the background and basics behind mollusks in general. And then the next two videos, we're going to be discussing bivalves, gastropods, and cephalopods in more detail because those three classes of mollusks are probably the most important for paleontology because they have a very extensive fossil record and also are very common today. But this video is necessary to kind of lay the groundwork and act as a part one to those videos. So let's get started. First, we can see that mollusks include snails, clams, and cephalopods. So snails, as we can see in the top part of this left image here, we have a living snail and of course a fossil snail shell. And snails scientifically are called gastropods because they belong in the class gastropoda. And then we have clams in the middle of that picture, also showing a living and fossil clam respectively. And clams are in the class bivalvia and are therefore called bivalves because they have two valves. And then we have at the bottom cephalopods. And cephalopods include nautiluses, octopuses, squids, belemnites, extinct ammonites, like what was in my title slide, and more. And so all of these groups, as we can tell, are extremely diverse. I mean, you wouldn't think that a squid and a slug have much in common, but they do. And that's being mollusks. And so because mollusks have such diversity, they can live in a variety of environments, and this includes marine environments, freshwater environments, and terrestrial environments. Additionally, they can live in a multitude of ways. They can be epifaunal, infaunal, planktonic, swimming, and even swimming predators. And we'll talk about what all that means in more detail in the later videos when we talk about each class specifically and kind of their ecology. But one more important fact I wanted to include on this slide, just to get you excited for the cephalopod video, is that mollusks include the most intelligent animal of all invertebrates, and that is the octopus. And I think that's really, really cool. So I hope that gets you excited for the cephalopod video. But today we need to get into the shared characteristics of all of these mollusks. So what exactly do these intelligent octopuses have in common with a slug? So in terms of the general mollusk body plan, they have unsegmented, soft, fleshy bodies, which are all bilaterally symmetrical and have a distinct head and tail end. They also tend to have a ribbon-like string of teeth called a radula or radulae plural, but this is not in all groups of mollusks, but we can see that in snails it is present, and we can kind of see that by the far right image on this slide. We can see that ribbon of teeth, which is kind of crazy. You think snails are just so soft and sweet, but they have these crazy teeth in their mouth. But speaking more about those soft and squishy parts, they do have what's called a foot, which is pretty much what we just call their body. And their foot is used either for crawling in things like gastropods. We can see all of the green part there is pretty much his foot, besides the head and the mouth, of course. And it can also be used for burrowing, for example, in clams. As we can see on the bottom middle picture, we have a clam here with its foot sticking out, and that is going to help it to burrow into the sand. And then they can also be used for tentacles, for example, in cephalopods. And we'll, of course, talk about that more in that video. So now we can see in this picture all of the different groups we've been talking about so far, mainly gastropods and how they use their foot to crawl around, and bivalves, which use their foot for burrowing, as well as scaphopods, which we haven't discussed yet, but we'll discuss more in the classification section. These guys are called tusk shells sometimes because they have tusk-shaped shells, as we'll see later, and you can see their foot comes out of that tusk, and it actually is used for burrowing, just like in bivalves. Additionally, there are cephalopods, and we can see here their foot or soft parts are pretty much all tentacles, and these are used for swimming around and catching prey and all of that. So what about some other characteristics labeled on this picture? Well, we see here in this picture, a common characteristic we keep seeing is a calcareous shell that protects the animal. Of course, it's not in all mollusks that they have a shell. For example, a squid down at the bottom does not have a shell, but in most mollusks, there is a shell that is calcareous, calcium carbonate material that is secreted by the mantle of the animal. And these shells have distinct layers in mollusks. And these layers include an outer organic layer or periostracum shown at the top, that thin outer layer that's organic material that is present when they're alive, but typically does not preserve. So it's not as important for studying paleontology because you typically don't have it there. But the two that can preserve are the calcite and aragonite layers below that periostracum. And we can see the difference in structure between the calcite and the aragonite layer. The aragonite layer is also sometimes called the nacreous layer and also is nicknamed the mother of pearl. And we can see that in this picture showing the bottom of the valve of this clam, there's this super shiny white layer. And that's why this is called mother of pearl, because it looks pearl-esque because it's what pearls are made of. It's aragonite and it's, you know, pearly. So getting into the classification of mollusks, there are 9 classes listed here, and these include Caudofoveta, Aplacophora, Polyplacophora, Monoplacophora, Gastropoda, Cephalopoda, Rostroconchia, Bivalvia, and Scaphopoda. So like I already mentioned, we are going to have separate videos for bivalves and gastropods, and then one for cephalopods as well. And that is why in this tree of mollusk classes, we are not going to be focusing on those 3 classes in this video. And I know you guys are thinking, you're like, how much really is there to say about snails? But guys, I just finished the PowerPoint this morning for bivalves and gastropods, and that sucker is packed full of information. So anyway, they're worth it, just like this video. So let's get into these classes that we still have listed here to go over. First, we have Caudofoveta or Caudofoveta. I hope I'm saying that right. But anyway, these have no shells, are worm-like in morphology, and they live by burrowing into the seafloor. And because they have no shell, they have no fossil record. And so these guys aren't super important for paleontology, which is why they're not getting their own video. Additionally, Aplacophora also has no shell. The name actually means that it bears no shell. And so they have very little fossil record. However, they have a little bit of one because they actually do have calcite spicules, but those don't typically preserve in structure. They're just kind of spread out in the rock record. So very little fossil record, again, not super important for paleontology. But in terms of the ecology of these guys, they live in water deeper than 200 meters in and around cnidarians, which are corals, which I have a video about. If you want to check out more about cnidarians, I will link that video right here. But anyway, in terms of Aplacophora, I think these guys are really cool just for the fact that they kind of live in deeper water, which isn't super common among invertebrates. But other than that, they're not super great in terms of fossils. So for that reason, we're going to move on to the more paleontological classes, such as Polyplacophora. Polyplacophora is actually named for its many shells, but really it's just one shell that's segmented. And so this is really interesting because Polyplacophora is actually the only class of mollusks that has a segmented shell. And so right away you might be thinking, well, shouldn't this be more like arthropod? It's segmented. But no, anatomically they are mollusks. They're just kind of an evolutionary branch off by themselves. If you remember the picture we looked at earlier, we have them over here, over to the side on this little diverged branch over here, because that's their kind of evolutionary experiment. They evolved segmented shells, and that's why they're really lesser related to all of these guys over here. They also have a muscular band that surrounds their segmented shell. This is called a girdle, and we can see in the bottom right picture here, this is a picture of a polyplacophore in life crawling around a surface, a rock surface, or a different animal surface. And they use this muscular girdle to help them crawl around, but they also use their foot for that as well. So in terms of their preservation, the plates of their shell kind of break apart after death, and therefore their fossil record is really not the best. So moving to Monoplacophora, getting a little bit closer to our regular gastropods, bivalves, cephalopods with one shell, which is actually what the name of Monoplacophora means. And these guys are limpet-like and cap-like in shape. And we can see that in the picture here, as well as in the life picture at the bottom here. And I kind of like to think of these guys looking a little bit like the sorting hat from Harry Potter. I mean, look at that thing. So anyway, that's kind of how I remember what these guys look like. And this morphology of the monoplacophora class is very primitive in mollusks in general, and their anatomy is really indicative of a close relationship with annelida, which are segmented worms, because they have segmentation of paired gills, hearts, gonads, and muscles, and this kind of suggests that close relationship with annelida, which is another phylum of invertebrates that unfortunately we're not going to be talking about in this playlist because this is a paleontology playlist, and worms without shells obviously don't become preserved. So moving on from monoplacophora, we have Rostroconchia, which is the only extinct class of mollusks. These guys lived from the Cambrian to the late Permian. They went extinct in the Permo-Triassic extinction, and they have pseudo-bivalve shells, so they're almost in with bivalves, but not quite. They actually have an interior partition that says partition. I'm noticing that now. That's supposed to say partition, and that partition is called their pegma, and that connects the two valves. However, they're not classed in bivalvia because they lack ligaments, adductors, and other features that all bivalves include, and so this caused them to be placed in their own separate class. But they could have led to bivalve evolution, and they could have been a more primitive form of modern or more advanced bivalves. Additionally, we have Scaphopoda, the tusk shells we showed earlier, and these tusk shells obviously look like tusks now that we can see this bottom middle picture here, and so they're very aptly named, and we can see that they burrow into the sand, as we talked about earlier, with their foot and tentacles, and their long conical shells help them to breach the surface a little bit so they can continue to catch prey in the sediment and excrete waste out the surface and stuff. So that is all for the classes of mollusks that do not include bivalves, gastropods, and cephalopods, obviously. And so with that, we're going to move on to mollusk evolution in the broad sense, and then we'll get into more specifics with later videos. But in a broad sense, there are two main hypotheses. These include the Aculifera hypothesis, which posits that shells evolved twice in mollusks. So an example of convergent evolution there, which wouldn't be unheard of, especially for a trait that's so universally helpful to have a shell for protection and all that. So that would definitely be plausible. But there's also the Testaria hypothesis, which kind of solves that problem and posits that shells only had to evolve once in mollusks. And we can see in these graphs where we have the Aculifera hypothesis showing that the shells of monoplacophores, bivalves, scaphopods, gastropods, and cephalopods all evolved separately compared to the Aculifera, polyplacophores, and some unshelled groups. So these polyplacophore shells would have evolved separately than all the other shells in mollusk groups. And that would be understandable because polyplacophores do have such different shell types than the rest of the mollusks. Remember, those are the segmented types, and so it would make sense that they evolved separately. But then in Testaria, we see that all the shelled groups of mollusks are clumped into having evolved first as polyplacophores, then mono, then bivalves, then scaphopods, gastropods, and cephalopods. So all of these shells would have just evolved once and then diversified and evolved into different types of shells because we have these unshelled groups separate from the shelled groups. However, this is still up for debate. If you would like to research mollusk evolution, it's still being looked at in terms of these two hypotheses, and there's quite a lot of evidence for both. So I encourage you to go into that if you're interested. So now moving to mollusk evolution, we have, obviously, like we always do, this timeline of Paleozoic to Mesozoic, and we start with the evolution of monoplacophores and rostroconchs at the beginning of the Cambrian. Then we have scaphopods and polyplacophores evolve in the Ordovician, and I say to our knowledge because, like we mentioned earlier, polyplacophores don't have the best fossil record, so it's extremely possible that they evolved in the early Cambrian as well, or even before then, and just there isn't much fossil record to show it. But then we move on to the Devonian, where we once thought that monoplacophores actually went extinct, but it turns out they didn't, and they're still around today, and we didn't actually know that for a long time. And so this is another point to emphasize that there's a lot to figure out in terms of mollusks if you're interested. And then we have the rostroconchs go extinct. Like we talked about, this is the only class that is known to have gone extinct, and they went extinct at the Permo-Triassic extinction. And then we have the rest of the group survive until today. And so it's not a super exciting same timeline without the other classes involved. And so if we try and include those other classes, we can see that, well, for one, Cabo Favela and Aplacophora classes likely evolved early in the Cambrian before the shelled groups. But like we mentioned earlier, without shells, there's no record to really tell. And then also we have bivalves, gastropods, and cephalopods evolving in the mid to late Cambrian to our knowledge. And then bivalves dominated in the Mesozoic era, and some types of cephalopods like ammonites were also really common then too. And so we'll talk way more about bivalve, gastropod, and cephalopod evolution in the next two mollusk videos. But for now, this is the general mollusk evolution chart. And with that, I thank you guys for watching, and I hope this was helpful to you in learning a little bit about mollusk characteristics, groups, and evolution. And I hope that you are excited as I am to come back and learn more about bivalves, gastropods, and cephalopods. Wow, I don't think I've ever said bivalves, gastropods, and cephalopods so much in one day. But anyway, I hope you come back for those videos. And with that, I'm gonna let y'all go. Thanks again for watching, and I can't wait to see you guys next time. Bye. Additionally, Aculifera. I feel like I'm trying to say like Harry Potter spells. Like Aculifera. Like, wouldn't that be like a spell? I think I said it that time. Right? Aw, damn.